I am Jenny and welcome to FREEJOO, the global community of educators. Let me show you why as an educator you should make FREEJOO an important part of your teaching and learning practice. A community of teaching practice is important for any educator. On FREEJOO you will be able to access CollabEd, which is like LinkedIn but for educators. Here you will be able to connect and network with other educators from all around the world. You can build your own community of teaching practice and or join one of the many other existing groups and learn and share ideas, lesson plans, etc. with each other. Then, for a more formalized approach to professional development, you can go to SkillEd, which is like Netflix for educators. Here, you will be able to access a wide range of courses designed by global experts that will help you to learn about new pedagogical, technical, and soft skills, all related to 21st century education and the future of work. There are more than 20 courses available for free, and for more advanced level courses, you can upgrade to the Silver membership plan for just $20 per year and get access to all courses designed by Akadasia. The courses are available in English and in several other Asian languages. And what's more, you will receive a free verifiable and tamper-proof digital certificate for each course that you complete. If you have upgraded your membership to the Silver, Gold, or Platinum plans, you also get access to DesignEd, which is like Canva for educators. Here you will find the easiest and fastest way to practice your own instructional design skills and build your own courses. We have pre-integrated several third-party edtech apps like Flipgrid, Canva, Mentimeter, Padlet, H5P, Zoom, etc. right into FREEJOO, so you can make your courses engaging and fun for your own learners. As you can see, there is a lot you can do on FREEJOO as an educator. So what are you waiting for? Go to www.freejoo.com and get your very own free lifetime membership today. See you soon on FREEJOO.
Hi, hello everybody. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening. Welcome back to yet another virtual event from Akadasia and FREEJOO. If you've attended our events before, you probably have seen me earlier. My name is Nilesh. I'm the co-founder and the CEO of Akadasia. And it's my pleasure to actually welcome all of you here today to this particular workshop. Let me get right to it. Today's topic is teaching framework, and we're going to be talking about Gagne's 9 events of instruction. And you'll notice that instead of a webinar Wednesday, today is a workshop Wednesday. So there is a change in the way we are going to be running this particular event as far today. So let me just kind of run you through that before we get into the lesson proper. Before I do that, just wanted to kind of highlight once again that FREEJOO does provide 21st century education to educators. We also help increase the supply of trained educators, and we help education institutions generate an additional source of revenue. And currently, there are more than 130,000 teachers from about 35 countries on the platform. So if you haven't signed on as yet, please do so at the earliest. It's a free lifetime membership. And of course, you can upgrade for other features later. But at least, you know, on the free membership, you will get about 20 plus courses, which you can access straight away. So so that's as far as FREEJOO is concerned. So this is, I also wanted to kind of share with you our upcoming schedule of events. This is webinar Wednesdays. So we had a virtual event called Practical Approaches to Increasing Your Happiness last week, last Wednesday. And this week, there is no webinar Wednesday. This week, there is a workshop Wednesday. So as you can see, it's every alternate Wednesdays. We'll be alternating between webinars and workshops. Webinars are going to be more about you know, discussions, like a fireside chat where we will bring in experts who will discuss various topics. So you can see the schedule here on your screen. On the 19th of January, we have something called Importance of Better Interpersonal Skills. On the 9th of February, we will be running a session on building assertiveness and self-confidence. On the 23rd of February, we'll be running a session on the importance of being a good digital citizen, and so on and so forth. And all these events, all the webinar Wednesday events, are absolutely free. If you log into freejoo.com and create your free account, after the event, you can actually log into the accompanying course for these events and get your free certificate as well. So that's as far as webinar Wednesdays are concerned. Today, we are going to be running a workshop. So this is Workshop Wednesdays. It's every alternate Wednesday. So today, the first workshop that we are launching is something called Understanding Gagne's 9 Events of Instruction. So that's what we're going to be doing today. But again, after 2 weeks, on the 26th of January, I'll be running another session called A Practical Approach to Using Gagne's 9 Events of Instruction. So today is going to be theory. In 2 weeks' time, we will actually apply that theory live in a very practical way, which will allow you to see how to take the theory that we are discussing today and build it into an online course. Okay. On the 16th of February, we will be running a session on how do you build engagement with your students using Flipgrid as an app. We will also be talking about the H5P tool on the 2nd of March and the 16th of March. So as you can see, there are a whole range of workshops that we are launching today, every alternate Wednesday. So you will basically get an entire array of workshops for you to learn from and upgrade your own skills and become a 21st century educator. However, for these workshops, anybody can attend the events. The events are all free. However, to attain an e-certificate for these workshops, you will need to upgrade your membership from free to premium to either gold, silver, or platinum. And I'll talk about that as to how you can do that at the end of the of this particular presentation. But this is just to kind of set the context so that you're aware we're running two kinds of events. We have the webinar Wednesdays and workshop Wednesdays. Today is a workshop Wednesday. All right, and we're going to be talking about understanding Gagne's 9 events of instruction. So let's get right to it. This is the objective for today's presentation. I'm going to be talking about who is Gagne before getting into his conditions of learning theory. And I will then also touch upon how we implement Gagne's theory within our classrooms. And finally, of course, I will provide the theoretical aspect behind 9 events of instruction. So those are our objectives for today. But before I move ahead, I have a question that I wanted to ask all of you. And perhaps if you could type in the comments section with your responses, that will be really amazing. So the question is very simple. What do you do that makes teaching fun for you? Okay, not for your students, but for you. So what do you do that makes teaching fun for you? I'll give all of you maybe a minute or two. If you could just type into the chat and tell me, what do you do that makes teaching fun for you? So go ahead, type into the comment section and let me know. And we can, you know, probably take, do a small discussion from there and then move forward. So I'll just wait for another minute or so before people can start posting their responses. So once again, the question is, what do you do that makes teaching fun for you? Okay, it's a very interesting question because a lot of the times as teachers, we forget about ourselves. Okay, we forget about ourselves. So again, this is not a question which asks you about how you make your lessons fun for your students. This is about you. So we have Miss Jessica Ibal, who says field exploration and games. Thank you very much for that. Anybody else? Make it engaging with the students, says Mr. Alfred. That's great, but how? Give me an example. How would you make it engaging with the students, right? Games, again, Mr. Ferdy says, when I check students' exams and hear them out during recitations. Okay, so that's more fun for you. Miss Sweet Cell says making creative instructional materials. Okay, that's a very, very good answer. Make use of apps and tools available. So yeah, there's so many ways you can actually make sure that teaching is fun for you. Because if it's not, then I think we are doing a disservice not just to ourselves, but also to our learners. And of course, these days, students are smart enough to know when teachers are not happy, when the teachers are not having fun themselves. Okay, they're very, very smart to kind of realize that very quickly. And of course, once you're on screen, like I am at the moment with you, you will probably know how I feel, what my body language is, and it's very easy to read that, you know, in a very visual medium like this. So again, you have to find ways to make teaching fun for you. For me, this is what I do to make teaching fun for me. I actually love researching about new frameworks, teaching and learning frameworks, pedagogical frameworks. And I learn from there, and I then want to try and apply all those theories into my own lessons when I design them. So that makes it fun for me because I'm, you know, not using the same style at, you know, for every course. I can learn something new and I can apply it. And that keeps things interesting for me. And that's exactly where we come in today with Gagne's 9 events of instruction. So let's begin with who is Gagne? So one of the leading pioneers to a systematic approach in teaching is none other than Robert Mills Gagne, an American educational psychologist. He's best known for his conditions of learning and developed his model after observing the thought processes of adults when they were presented with mental challenges. He focused on how people were able to achieve specific learning goals and created instructional events to help them attain those objectives. His theory is based heavily on how people process information and has subsequently been applied even beyond the field of teaching to engineering, healthcare, space tech, and even the military. He went on to develop a series of studies and works that simplified and explained what he and others believed to be good instruction. Okay, good instruction. Central to Gagne's theory are his conditions of learning. These consist of both internal and external conditions that affect the student during his or her learning journey. Internal conditions refer to the anterior knowledge that the student has before the topic is presented. And the external conditions refer to the behaviors or stimuli presented by the instructor. And an effective teacher must recognize that both internal and external affect conditions affect learning. Internal conditions also refer to the general knowledge we've already acquired and have already placed in our memory. This so-called semantic memory covers everything from our prior knowledge of objects, people, and words to facts, ideas, and concepts. What this means is what we already know or think we know has a strong bearing on how we absorb or interpret additional learning, okay? So keep that in mind. It's very important for us to kind of understand this conditions of learning theory if we are to kind of implement Gagne's theory in our classrooms. Apart from internal conditions, so does the immediate and physical learning environment. Whether it's the tone of the voice of the instructor, a claustrophobic or stuffy meeting space, or a laptop with poor Wi-Fi, external conditions all have a bearing on how we connect or not with the content of a training or learning program. And this is so true, isn't it? I mean, if you just kind of reflect on your own classes that you are conducting online or even within a physical environment, a lot of the times, it really helps if you can connect the dots and help the students see what you're trying to explain to them by connecting the dots to something that they already know. That's the interior condition of learning. And if you are teaching online, a lot of the times your students might not be on a fast Wi-Fi connection. Maybe they don't have a laptop. Maybe they're accessing the entire lesson on a phone. That is your external condition. So maybe, you know, it's not the most optimum way to learn for the students. So it is very important for you to understand both the internal and external conditions of learning before we move up to the two steps to implement Gagne's theory. So the two steps are basically stating outcomes and organizing events. Okay. So first, Gagne theory says to state the desired results. Okay, we need to state, we be very clear about what are the results that you are expecting from your students when you design a course. These results can be classified into five categories: intellectual skills, cognitive strategies, verbal skills, attitudes, and motor skills. Okay, there are five parts to stating outcomes. So let's dive a little bit deeper into each one of these. So the first one is intellectual skills. It is also known as procedural skills and is the easiest way to identify a student's readiness. Okay? These skills encompass concepts, procedures, and rules, and they're also referred to as knowing how something must be done. For this, when you are trying to figure this out in your own lessons, you might want to try out using different contexts and perspectives. You might want to plan opportunities to practice for students to practice whatever it is that you are trying to teach them and assess the same. Use verbal indications for combining skills, knowledge, and components, and encourage the retrieval of previously gained knowledge and stay within the limits of the working memory. Remember, not too much at once. Okay, pace yourselves and go slow. And ask attention for deviating characteristics. Okay. The second one is cognitive strategies. Gagne's conditions of learning defines the cognitive strategy as the way to enable students to exercise control over the processes involved in participating, observing, remembering, retrieving, and thinking in general. In other words, it means that the student develops his or her own personal way to learn, think, and act. The instructions that are given form the essence of the cognitive perspective. Okay, so for this, you might want to describe or demonstrate strategies. You might want to plan opportunities to practice the strategy and to assess the action after, and give information and constructive feedback on the creativity or originality of a developed strategy or outcome. The third is verbal skills, which is also called explanatory knowledge. These determine whether the student is able to explain what he or she has learned. Explanatory knowledge consists of different types of knowledge that can be recalled in different ways. Okay. Here, Gagne describes previously learned knowledge helps in learning new information. So for this, when you're looking at your stated outcomes for verbal skills, you might want to look at providing a meaningful context for effectively coding information. Okay, you might want to encourage the retrieval of previously gained knowledge, or encourage the generalization of information. and present information in a manageable way. And of course, ask attention again for deviating characteristics. 4 is attitudes. Attitudes are internal conditions that can't always be perceived directly. Gagne's conditions of learning describes attitudes as emotional components and cognitive components because they influence behavior. Attitudes also refer to the bias that influences the learner's action compared to something or someone else. Okay. Here, you might want to look at developing success expectations based on the desired attitude. So you might want to be very clear about what you're expecting from the students, you know, what kind of attitude they need to demonstrate in order for you to gauge whether they've been successful in the learning or not. You want to make sure that students have a role model, and you want to give feedback for successful achievements. And generally, this feedback, the faster you can give that feedback, the better it is. I think students these days will not do anything if they are not given constant feedback. So it's very important for us as instructors to make sure that we have enough components in our instructional design that we are providing regular constant feedback to the students. The next one and the last one here in terms of the outcomes, when you want to state outcomes, is motor skills. Motor skills entail that it is analyzed whether the student uses the right order when carrying out procedures. Okay. This concerns combining sub-skills. When improvement occurs in the smoothness of an action, the timing and the motion through practice, we call this motor learning. Here, you might want to plan opportunities to practice and assess. You might want to share verbal or other guidelines to determine the routine. And you might also want to share feedback on the accuracy of achievements immediately. This is exactly what I mentioned earlier as well. And encourage the use of mental exercises. Okay. Which brings us to the actual 9 events. Okay. And appropriately organizing Gagne's events of instruction is the second step in this approach. According to Gagne, learning must be made as easy as possible by supporting the internal processes, which is your previous knowledge that you already have, through the proper planning of educational activities. To make learning easier, Gagne listed a series of 9 instructions that support the learning process. He noted that these 9 instructions should be used in every lesson. And these 9 instructions are, at level 1, gaining attention of the students. At level 2, informing the learner of the objective. At level 3, stimulating recall of prior learning. At level 4, presenting the content. At level 5, providing learning guidance. At level 6, eliciting performance. And at level 7, providing feedback. At level 8, assessing the performance. And at level 9, enhancing retention and transfer of knowledge. So these are the 9 steps. Okay. And Gagne's steps are meant to be used in a sequential order, starting with level 1 and moving all the way through to level 9. Okay, remember this. It has to be used ideally in a sequential order. Of course, if you ask me personally, I think it really depends on how you want to design the lesson. Sometimes, you know, you might want to move the levels based on what you are trying to do, but this is the recommendation where you want to move up from level 1 to level 9 in a sequential order. And as you utilize each step, the theory states that learners should become more engaged and more invested in the subject matter. Okay? So let us begin and let's really dive deep into understanding what these different nine levels are. So the first one is gaining your learners' attention. Okay? So as soon as your learning experience begins, you must capture your learners' attention. By presenting a powerful stimulus at the start, which is very essential for gaining learners' interest and sustaining motivation and engagement. And some examples to gain your learners' attention might include tips for gaining, might include playing a humorous video clip, or asking a thought-provoking question, telling an emotional story, or sharing surprising statistics or facts, telling jokes, polling the audience, presenting a challenge, playing a game, so on and so forth. So let me ask all of you, when I started the presentation, do you think I used step one today? And if so, what did I do in order to gain your attention? You might want to type this out in the chat once again. What do you think I did at the beginning of the presentation to gain your attention? Did I do anything from here in this list? Please type in the chat so we can actually read that out and share it with the audience as well. Anyone? Did I gain your attention right at the beginning of the presentation today? So yes, Ms. Jessica says yes by asking a question. Correct. 100% correct. I started the presentation proper by asking all of you a question that made you think about your own experiences. And you also kind of had to, you know, dig deep into your prior knowledge to kind of, you know, provide the answer, right? So I kind of just nudged you there a little bit right at the beginning so that you are able to, you know, retrieve information from your memory and provide an answer. And then we connected that to the entire lesson. So that's the first thing, gaining attention. Okay, fantastic. Okay, the second thing is we inform learners of the objectives. So once your learners are engaged, they need to know what to expect from your learning experience. This helps your audience understand the full picture. Providing expectations around what they will learn helps put your audience in a learning mindset. Here are some tips for defining your learning objectives. So create an objective slide, or you can explain what the audience will learn and why is that important. You can describe the goals and outcomes of the learning experience and explain how this information will benefit the learners. So, next question, did I have a slide in the presentation today which provided all of you with objectives of what we are going to be covering in the presentation? Did I have a slide for objectives? Yes, no? Anyone? So my question again is, did I have a slide in my presentation today in which I had objectives clearly laid out about what we are going to be learning today? Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Ms. Lourdes and Ms. Zenril. I hope I pronounced that name correctly, ma'am. So yeah, absolutely. We did have a slide which very specifically stated what the objectives were. Three, stimulate recall of prior learning. Okay. Many cognitive psychologists suggest that leveraging prior knowledge is critical to continuing knowledge. That is, new knowledge builds upon old knowledge that's already stored in our long-term memory. Once the old knowledge is recalled, it makes it easier to connect the dots to new information. Here are some tips for you to help stimulate for stimulating recall in your own lessons. You can ask questions from the last lesson, or you can conduct pop quizzes. You might want to post discussion board questions related to prior knowledge. You can even do pre-tests to understand what the audience already knows, or create lesson plans that build upon each other. Okay. Now, for this, I'm going to go back into my slides a bit more. So let me just go back and help you recall this. So if you see this here, I mentioned that we will be, we are basically going through this particular workshop today. 2 weeks from now, I will be building up on today's lesson and showing you a practical approach on how to actually use Gagne's nine events in a real live online course. Okay, we will show you that on the 26th. So what I'm in effect doing is I'm building my second workshop on top of what we are doing today. And at that point, I might even ask you some questions about what we covered today. And similarly, in this particular lesson, I will be using Flipgrid. I will be using H5P. I will be using Canva, Lumen 5, and many other tools. And eventually, all of these workshops are going to be built and designed one on top of the other. So if you miss the first lesson, for example, it may be difficult for you to understand what's coming in next. So it is. So this is the way we've structured our workshops, which allows us to basically create lesson plans that build on top of one another. I hope that's very clear in how we are designing our lessons. And I just wanted to kind of share that with you as an example, right? Because this is the very first workshop that we are running. So we don't have anything that we've done prior, but we are connecting this now to the future workshops. So let's move to number four, which is present the learning content. And this is the most straightforward step of all. Why? Because this is where you do the teaching. Okay. This is where a variety of different approaches can be used to present the learning content to the learners. Make sure to adjust and use appropriate methods if you're creating an instructor-led learning program or a virtual learning program which is run online. As you're developing your presentation of learning content, it's important to remember a few key tips. Make sure that your learning content is well organized and structured in small chunks, especially in e-learning. Ensure that the content is engaging by using images, videos, and relevant multimedia. And you can assign books, watch videos, perform lectures, require writing, do activities and projects, and homework assignments. Now, when you're running an online session like what we are doing today, sometimes it becomes very difficult for us to get audience to engage with us, okay? And I'm sure you probably have the same problem as well. So that's why what we've now started doing is for every workshop that we are running, there is a course attached to this particular workshop in FREEJOO. So when you log into FREEJOO, you can actually go through an entire course about the same thing that I'm telling you today. And in that course, you will see that there will be videos to watch. You will be required to, answer a few things. You will be required to actually record your own videos. So there's a lot of engagement that happens in a course. And all of that in terms of presenting as a stimuli or a stimulus is all there present in the course. Okay. So if you're attending this today, please don't forget. You might want to upgrade your membership and actually access that course. It is called the Teaching Framework, Understanding Gagne's Nine Events of Instruction. It's an accompanying course to this workshop. Okay, so, and that's where all the stimulus is presented for this particular lesson. Number five, we provide guidance for learning. Okay, and as an instructional designer, you need to make the learning experience as simple and straightforward as possible. Sometimes that means providing exact instructions on where to click and what to do next. It may seem intuitive to you, but it often helps to be overly clear in your instructions to avoid any confusion. Hence, to provide learning guidance, you might want to consider providing expectations as needed, writing clear and concise instructions, providing an accessible next button for online learning experiences, and including tips on how better to navigate the course. And once again, I will go back here in my presentation, and as you can see here, I have provided a specific instruction on how you can access this course on the platform, and also access this particular presentation on the platform, because it's not going to be sent by email to anybody. You'll have to log into FREEJOO and upgrade your account to get access to all the materials with related to this particular workshop, right? So again, instructions need to be absolutely crystal clear. I've actually seen this in many courses. A lot of the times, teachers expect that students will read and understand. It doesn't happen. You have to be very, very specific in, you know, what they're supposed to read, when they're supposed to respond to you, how they are supposed to respond to you, what format you want the responses in. All of that has to be absolutely crystal clear, okay? So number six is eliciting performance. So after the content is presented, you need to allow time for learners to practice. The mix of repetition and recall is critical to any deep learning. After all, this is the first time your audience has the chance to apply what they have learned. And to elicit performance, you might want to try knowledge checks, quizzes, and tests, or e-learning branching scenarios, activities, projects, and writing assignments, role-playing situations, group discussions, and sharing. So once again, for this particular workshop, we will be requiring you to show us and perform for us, basically, right? How do we do that? Again, through the course. We will require all the people who've actually signed up for the course to record a video and explain to us what they have learned. We will require them to get into a group discussion. There are knowledge checks and quizzes built right into the course. And as far as e-learning branching scenarios are concerned, so let me kind of touch upon this a little bit more. This is something that you can actually use very effectively to personalize learning for your students, okay? What you can do is, based on what the students are completing, you might want to open up new, you know, reading material or new information for them to learn from as well. So depending on how fast or how slow they learn, you can provide more specific, more personalized approaches to each student. It is more time consuming for sure. 100% is more time consuming when you are designing or your actual lesson to begin with. But once you've designed it, and once you see how students actually learn from it, you will be surprised at the engagement that you get from the students, because students appreciate their teachers doing things for them at a very personal level. And you know, with the branching scenarios, you can actually personalize education, personalize your own lessons for your own students. And that itself is a whole different workshop, which we will cover in one of our future sessions after May. So look out for that. There will be a whole session on how do you actually personalize your lessons for different students as well. So moving forward, we now move to provide timely feedback. So personalized immediate feedback is most effective for learning. Feedback is the only way your learners know what they're doing correctly and what they need to improve upon. This is easier to implement for instructor-led learning experience than for e-learning, but it can still be done. To provide feedback, you might want to try personalized written feedback on assignments and projects, detailed rubrics outlining both positive and negative feedback, and using peer evaluation assessments, okay? So there are different ways to actually do assessments. And in fact, we will be covering one session. I don't recall the date, But there is one session where we will be covering video assessments, how you can assess your students' learning using videos. Okay, so you might want to look out for that workshop as well. But there are ways for you to personalize your own feedback to your own students as well. So that's step number 7. Step 8 is assessing performance. Okay, step 8 is assessing performance. Recall or remembering is the ultimate way to learn. When you try to remember something, your brain replays a similar pattern of neural activity that you already experienced before. The more practice you have at remembering this information, the more solidified this similar pattern becomes. Assessments are the formal way to test learner recall. This helps learners understand what they already know and what they need to spend more time learning. And assessments also capture important learning data to help us as designers improve future instruction. And here are some tips for that. You might want to include pop quizzes, use written exams, and of course, assess as often as you can throughout the course. And again, if you've ever taken any of our courses on FREEJOO, you will know that we constantly have quizzes, video reflections, and all of this kind of stuff built right into the course, because we are constantly assessing performance. And not only are we assessing the performance of how you learn and, you know, what you've learned, but we are also assessing our own performance as instructional designers. What we are looking at is basically seeing, are my learners able to follow instructions? Are they able to complete the courses on schedule? Are they able to gain all the knowledge which I set out, for them as learning objectives? Are they able to gain all those learning objectives? And if I find that, no, this is not working, then we will go back and, you know, tweak the course. So we never run the same course twice. If we feel that it can be improved, there's constant improvement going on even within our own team. So in fact, our chief academics officer, Dr. Kirsten, and her team, we've got great team of very talented young teachers who are always going through the course themselves, and they're assessing the teacher's performance, which is your performance when you go through our courses, and we're also assessing our own performance as to how we've done as instructional designers. So this is something that you might also want to take away from this from this session. And the last point in Gagne's 9 events of instruction is enhancing retention and transfer. Okay. So at the end of your instruction, learners need to be able to apply their knowledge to real world situations. This step is arguably the most difficult of all Gagne's events. Make sure you spend plenty of time allowing learners to practice themselves. And try these things to help your learners enhance retention. Use real world scenarios and build in time for real-world practice. You can also build in interactive e-learning activities and allow for flexible learning opportunities and continuously use examples of real-world situations. And this is something that, again, if you've ever attended any one of my lessons for teacher training, you will know I'm constantly connecting the dots to show how this can be applied in a real-world situation. And even over here, today is just theory, but in 2 weeks when we run the follow-up workshop for this one, I will actually be showing you how we can apply Gagne's 9 events of instruction in a real-world scenario by developing a course live on the platform, right? So that's basically where it's at as far as the 9 events of instruction are concerned. Now, let me play for you a very simple example and a quick example of how someone has implemented Gagne's 9 events of instruction for training, believe it or not, cats. Okay, I'm not sure if you like cats. If you do, you might want to comment in the chat that if you like cats or if you're a dog person. Unfortunately, I don't have a dog video, but we do have a cat video. And so this particular person is training cats using Gagne's 9 events of instruction. So let me share this video with you. Pretty interesting. And And that'll basically put into practice exactly what I've been talking about all this while. So let me just remove this first and add this to the stream. And there you go. I hope you liked that video. I thought it was a really unique way to explain Gagne's 9 events of instructions, using cats. I'm not a cat person myself. I love dogs, but, you know, I couldn't find a video with dogs. So we'll just have to make do with cats for today. So this primarily brings us to the end of, a very brief, quick understanding of what Gagne's 9 events of instruction are. And in about 2 weeks' time, I will show you how to actually deploy this in a real, world scenario by designing a course live here. I will show you how I'm applying that to create a course. So having said that, let me just move to the next slide, which basically now opens up the floor for questions. And whilst we're waiting for questions to be... I think all of you have a Mentimeter link. So if you have a question, please do, type it in the Mentimeter and I will try and address them as and how. But in the meantime, let me also share with you once again, specific instructions on how you can log into FREEJOO. And if you have a free account already with us, please upgrade your free account to either a gold, silver or platinum account. And once you've done that, you can then access and complete the course, Teaching Framework, Understanding Gagne's 9 Events of Instruction. And once you've completed all of that, you will get your e-certificate by email. Okay, so just keep that in mind. I'm going to leave this here on the screen so that you can digest this while we look at answering the questions. So let's look at the questions that we have. Okay. Great. So Zarina is asking, how do you apply these 9 events of instruction in a 40-minute synchronous class? Great question, Zarina. Please join us in 2 weeks. I'm going to be doing exactly that. I will show you how I will apply all these 9 steps in a real course, using a learning management platform. So how do you actually quickly build and assemble your course using these 9 steps? And I will show you that in 2 weeks' time. So please do join us for that. Any other questions that we have? I'm just going to check with my team if there are any other questions here. There's one more. In this time of pandemic, we are engaging distance learning, either online, modular type of learning. How can you make it more challenging and exciting and insightful for the learners? My view on this is a bit different. I think, why are we continuing as educators to use the pandemic as an excuse to make distance learning engaging, or any kind of learning engaging? I think as educators, it is our duty to make learning engaging no matter what the situation outside, whether there is a pandemic or whether it's a regular situation outside. It shouldn't matter. You should still find ways to make your lessons fun, not just for your students, but also for you. And that's why, we have all these workshops and events for all of you, so that you can learn from here and apply these strategies in your own lesson design and in your own courses. And this is very, very important. So there's so many things you can do. And we will be covering a lot of these strategies in the next couple of weeks through these workshop events. So please do continue coming back every Wednesday and learning new things so that you can apply them to your course as well. Okay, there is another question. Do these 9 events occur in one class session, or can they be spread out through different sessions? Great question. That's a brilliant question. And again, these can be applied either way. Okay, you could actually run the whole thing in one class, or you can design your entire semester long, with these 9 steps. So it really depends on how you design your course. So like I said earlier, that you can actually build, say, week 2 lesson on top of week 1, and then you can build week 3 lesson on top of week 2. So you can build you can build a course like that, or you can have all 9 events in per week, and let the students go through that entire cycle every week. Of course, it'll be probably more intense, but it can be done. Yeah, absolutely. So at this point, let me also invite my very good friend and our chief academics officer, Dr. Kirsten, who is here. Hi, Kirsten. Good morning.
Hey, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good.
Awesome. So yeah, Kirsten, do you have any questions with regards to Gagne's 9 events, or anything to share with the audience?
Well, I was just thinking about the question that you just answered about, is it one class or is it a full semester or a full? It depends. It really depends on your subject matter. I mean, if you were trying to teach me complex maths and you expect me to be able to do all that the first time we get together, not going to happen. Mm. But, setting it up to, establish what I need to know, drawing that memory. You have to go back a very long time for me to remember any math lessons. But it all depends on what you want to do. I know a lot of people who are watching right now, they're anxious. They want to know, how do they do this? And I know that you said, we shouldn't use the pandemic as an excuse anymore. And you're right. We can't anymore. We can use the pandemic as the opportunity to now reevaluate how we're teaching and how we're learning. Absolutely. So I'm excited that we're doing these workshops because they do provide very practical hands-on materials, which I think is awesome. And I know that people out there right now are like, yeah, but I want to know now. We're building the Gagne's 9 steps into our workshops as well. So we're not giving you everything today.
So there's a saying that patience pays. Patience pays, right? So the whole idea behind this entire series of workshops is very simple. Every 2 weeks, we are tackling one aspect of lesson design and instruction design. Okay, one aspect. And if we were to show you all the things today, chances are you will probably forget very, very quickly as well. So what we are basically doing is every 2 weeks, we are building upon what you already know, what you already have learned from these sessions. And we are building the knowledge on top of that. And we are just scaffolding the entire thing until we have the giant pyramid of Giza right inside your brains. So I've seen a lot of people asking us questions like, can you share the slides, or can we receive a certificate of participation? And to answer those questions once and for all, please look at your screen. You will get a certificate of participation, provided you are a gold, silver, or platinum member of the FREEJOO community. So you will need to upgrade your membership. If you're on a free plan, you will need to upgrade. And this also brings me to the point as to, if you want to upgrade your membership, there might be a question as to how much might that cost. Well, let me show you the price plans. So as you can see, it is not a very expensive proposition at all. In fact, you can start your paid membership at a silver plan, which is $20 a year. It's not a month. It's $20 a year, which is, I don't know, dollar and something every month, pretty much. Okay, which is less than four cups of Starbucks coffee. So what this will allow you to do is get access to all of the content on the platform, not just the free courses, but also the paid courses. You will get 70 plus courses on the platform. All these workshops, all the content attached to these workshops, you will get access to all of that. And you will get a e-certificate from all of this, from all of these courses and events. You will also be able to join the public groups, but more importantly, you will be able to create your own private communities of teaching practice. And in addition to that, you can also create five of your own courses. So you can, design your own courses, you can enroll your own students. And as you can see, it is not a very expensive proposition. This will allow you an opportunity to learn, get better at your craft. And then once you are better at your craft, we will be providing the teachers with opportunities for them to actually earn an extra revenue themselves. So you will very quickly find out that whatever investment that you've made in $20 a year, you're probably recouping that probably a lot more in the next 6 months time, once you have, been certified and doing all of that kind of stuff.
So, well, and please, if you're only interested in our workshop Wednesdays, if you think about it, if you sign up for the $20 plan, you're paying about $2, not only to go and participate with our live chat. And people, you can ask us any questions right now on Mentimeter, but also to take that course. So if you think about it, $2 to learn how to use things like H5P and Flipgrid and really become more engaging with your students. Yes, virtually, but you can use these things in synchronous classes as well. So the tools and instruction here, it's not just for online learning, but we really want to help people become better online educators, because that's the future of education. Whether we like it or not, a lot of our education is going to be virtual.
Yep. And even once we go back to physical environments, there will be virtual parts to your classes. There will be digital tools that you will have to use. There will be pedagogical skills that you will have to apply, because the world has changed. Your students are different. They're not the students that you had before. This is a new generation that you're talking to. And as teachers, we really need to upgrade ourselves in that sense. So once again, a quick reminder for our workshop Wednesday. So we just completed the workshop for understanding Gagne's 9 events of instruction. On the 26th, of Jan, we will be doing a practical exercise where I will actually show you how we are applying these 9 events of instructions into an actual course, which will also include Flipgrid, H5P, and Canva, and all of that. And then in the subsequent workshops, we will be showing you how to actually use Flipgrid. How do you actually use H5P? How do you use Lumen5 and other, you know, tools? So that will help you build your palette of tools so that you can become a more powerful educator rather than just creating a course which is videos and text. Okay, so there's a lot more to it.
I still want that course to be about Star Wars, but I don't think I've convinced you that that's what we can do yet.
No, we're not going to do that. So anyway, once again, just a reminder, this is the entire schedule for workshop Wednesdays. And we also have webinar Wednesdays, which are absolutely free. And that's the schedule for webinar Wednesdays. So we already completed practical approaches to increasing your happiness on the 5th of Jan. The next week, which is 19th, we will be running a free webinar, a virtual event on importance of better interpersonal skills. So all these events that you see here to, on your screen right now, they're all free. Okay, so you can actually just sign up for a free membership. And then once the virtual event has ended, you can log into the system, complete the course, and get your certificate for each of these courses, right? I have some good news to share. We have just managed to secure our membership to the CPD accreditation service in the United Kingdom. So if I could go back here, so if you are paying $20, $35, or $50, by February, I think we will start having CPD accreditation from the United Kingdom for all the courses. Okay, so that's coming in. So again, you know, that accreditation will really go a long way. And yes, Ms. Sweetcell, this course is under SkillEd, but you need to be a premium member to be able to access it. Yeah. It is under, all the courses are under SkillEd. So if you search for it, you will be able to find all these courses. So if you just imagine right now, on Workshop Wednesdays, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. There are 10 events here in Workshop Wednesdays, and there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 events and Webinar Wednesdays. That's 20 events plus 20 courses because each event is attached with a course. And all of that is at $20 minimum. So basically you're paying a dollar per event, dollar per course, okay? Very, very affordable. So please do yourselves a favor and sign up. And Ms. Sweetcell, if you're already a silver member, then you should be able to access it. And if you're unable to access it, then please do reach out to our support teams. The email address is here on your screen, support@freejoo.com. Send them an email. They'll be more than happy to support you. And I guess with that, do we have any other questions from the audience?
I think you've basically covered them. People are asking the same basic thing. So I think that they're just excited for the next step, but they have to wait 2 weeks. Patience is a virtue.
So you have 2 weeks to go in and complete this course, for example, and learn from here. So when you come in for the next workshop, you will be able to apply what you've learned directly in the next course. So that's how we are building up our knowledge, right? So having said that, I think this brings us to the end of a very quick, short, and sweet workshop today. I hope this has been informative to all of you. I hope all of you enjoyed learning from this as much as I've enjoyed myself being here today and sharing this with you all as well. And next week, we will support, Dr. Kirsten will be there next week, as always, in a virtual fireside chat, where we will be talking about interpersonal skills. So until then, goodbye. And most importantly, please stay safe. Please stay safe. Thank you very much, everybody, and take care.
I am Jenny and welcome to FREEJOO, the global community of educators. Let me show you why as an educator you should make FREEJOO an important part of your teaching and learning practice. A community of teaching practice is important for any educator. On FREEJOO you will be able to access CollabEd, which is like LinkedIn but for educators. Here you will be able to connect and network with other educators from all around the world. You can build your own community of teaching practice and/or join one of the many other existing groups and learn and share ideas, lesson plans, etc. with each other. Then, for a more formalized approach to professional development, you can go to SkillEd, which is like Netflix for educators. Here, you will be able to access a wide range of courses designed by global experts that will help you to learn about new pedagogical, technical, and soft skills, all related to 21st century education and the future of work. There are more than 20 courses available for free, and for more advanced level courses, you can upgrade to the Silver membership plan for just $20 per year and get access to all courses designed by Akadasia. The courses are available in English and in several other Asian languages. And what's more, you will receive a free verifiable and tamper-proof digital certificate for each course that you complete. If you have upgraded your membership to the Silver, Gold, or Platinum plans, you also get access to DesignEd, which is like Canva for educators. Here you will find the easiest and fastest way to practice your own instructional design skills and build your own courses. We have pre-integrated several third-party edtech apps like Flipgrid, Canva, Mentimeter, Padlet, H5P, Zoom, etc. right into FREEJOO, so you can make your courses engaging and fun for your own learners. As you can see, there is a lot you can do on FREEJOO as an educator. So what are you waiting for? Go to www.freejoo.com and get your very own free lifetime membership today. See you soon on FREEJOO.